Church, it's up to us to spread the news, amen? It's up to us to get up out of our chairs and go speak to somebody that desperately needs to hear the word, the good news, that our God saves, that he is the truth, the light, and the way. It's up to us.
today. I wonder if you just take a moment with me to put ourselves into the crowd that day that crossed over to the Sea of Galilee, over to Capernaum, who just the day before had experienced a miracle of Jesus when he fed 5,000 people with the best fish and chips they had ever had. And so the crowd, we're with them, crossed over the Sea of Galilee, and we find Jesus in Capernaum. And you hear somebody in the crowd go, "Oh, hey, Jesus, when did you get here?" Well, Jesus sees through what they're really thinking. He says, "You're not seeking me because you understood these miraculous signs and what they mean. You're seeking me because you want another free meal." He says, "Don't seek for the food that perishes, but seek for the food that brings eternal life, which the Son of Man will give to you. The works you should be doing is to believe in me." Well, they couldn't escape thinking of the earthly mindset they had. So one of them kind of looks at the other and goes, "We're going to get a free meal out of this, watch." "Okay, well, what sign are you going to give us, Jesus, so we can believe in you? You know, our Father's got manna from heaven." Jesus picks up on their hung up on this bread concept. So he says to them, "I am the bread of life. I have come down from heaven to do the will of my Father. And his will is that everyone who looks on the Son and believes in him should have eternal life." Well, now the Jewish leaders in the crowd, they too kept having this literal earthly mindset. So all they hear in that is, "What is this he's talking about coming down from heaven? I mean, this is Jesus. I mean, we know his parents, for crying out loud." Well, Jesus says to them, "Don't grumble about this. I'm telling you, I am the bread of life. You know, your fathers ate manna in the wilderness, but guess what? They died. This perfect food that God provided miraculously for them was for their physical need, their physical hunger, but it could not keep them from death. I'm bringing you something. I'm trying to help you see what I'm coming for is to deal with you in a different way." And he tells them, "If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. And the bread that I will give for the life of the world is my flesh." But they still aren't getting it. They're still thinking of the literal, the earthly mindset. And so all they hear is, "Eat his flesh? This guy's crazy. Come on, man." Well, Jesus kind of doubles down here. He goes, "You think what I said's crazy? Listen to what I'm about to tell you. This is the truth of the matter. Unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoever feeds on my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day. For my flesh is true food, and my blood is true drink. Whoever feeds on my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me, and I in him." I mean, if you're thinking earthly and temporal and the here and now, that's whacked, right? What he just said. If all you're thinking about is an earthly physical mindset. And in fact, it was so profound and hard to hear that even many of the disciples who were pledged to follow him heard it. And they said, "This is really hard to take. Who can listen to this kind of talk?" But Jesus then tries to explain. He says, "It is the Spirit who gives life. The flesh is no help at all. The words that I have spoken to you are spirit and life." But their earthly mindset, they couldn't get over. And it says after that, many of his disciples turned back and no longer followed him. And I know that maybe some of us, even as believers, it's sometimes we get caught up on the here and now. And what Jesus is saying is, keep your focus on me. There is nothing we can do. There is no perfect food we can physically eat. There's nothing we can do in this life that's going to save us from death. Only Jesus can do that. So he says, feed on me. This isn't a one-time event when you pledged your faith in him. It's an everyday moment. Every morning we wake up, we need Jesus. Every person in here today, right now, including me, needs Jesus to feed on him, to take him in. He says, I want to come and abide with you. So as we come forward this morning and take communion together, let's just thank Jesus, who gave of himself as the bread of true life, eternal life. As we take of the bread and the cup, we'll proclaim him and thank him for all that he has done. When you come forward, you will find that there'll be two cups together. The juice will be nested in the cup with the bread. Take both cups, and when you are seated, hold on to them, and once everybody has theirs, I will lead us to take together. So please come forward. On the night when Jesus was betrayed, he took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which was given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he also took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Oh, Lord Jesus, we just thank you. Thank you, God, that you saw our spiritual depravity, that there was nothing we could do, Lord, about the devastating effects of sin in our life. Jesus, because of your great love for us, you came to deal with that because you want us to be with you. Help us, Lord, every day to see that we need you as much today as every day in the past, since we placed our faith in you. So may we feed on you every day, Lord. And thank you for giving us your body, shedding your blood, Lord. Forgiving our sins, Lord. Giving us your perfect righteousness, knowing that one day, God, we will spend eternity with you. Thank you, God. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
I'm going to invite you to stand one more time as we sing this song. I couldn't let it go. We got to sing. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy
the rocking announcement person apparently today to bring announcements, and just want to welcome all of you that are new here or have been here for years or a week or 2 weeks or however long. Glad to have all of you here. If you have not filled out a welcome card, we would love to get you one because we want to be connected with you. So if you are interested, you could raise your hand and bring that to the welcome center in the back later. So, and now I think for the rocking video maybe. Are we going to do the video now? Is that a good? Okay, perfect.
Hey guys, it's me here, Pastor Mark Johnson, and I'm here to promote Creative Arts Camp 2022, which is coming up here real quick, June 6th through the 10th. But you know what? We can't make this happen without your help, so come along with me and I'll show you where you can plug in. These are all the areas we still need help with. Painting. Percussion. Dance. Videography. I heard the teacher for that class is a real cool dude. 1, 2, 3. Voice.
you need to form good connections with these kids and guide them from class to class. Come on, kids, let's go!
If you're just sitting there and thinking, Pastor Mark, I just can't volunteer. Well, we also need water and snack donations as well. Creative Arts Camp is one of Grace Fellowship's biggest outreach opportunities of the year, and it is just such a ministry to our community and to our kids. So I encourage you to head on back to the table after service and sign up for one of these many opportunities. Hope to see you there.
And we get to hear him preach later also. Mark Johnson will be here to preach also. And will you dance while you're up on stage also today? I mean, this is great. So, awesome job, whoever made that video of Mark. So Creative Arts Camp is June 6th to the 10th. And as you saw in the video there, we have lots of opportunities for serving. The tables are in the back, and we would love you to sign up today after the service. Or donations, there's lots of ways to help. So just go back there and ask, and you will get some answers. So I'm really excited about this event coming up Thursday night. We have a charcuterie board. What is it? Charcuterie Women's Ministry Night. So it's a charcuterie board, but we're calling it charcuterie board, which I don't know. Maybe it's named after me. Or actually, maybe I need to invite y'all over for, because we love to do charcuterie boards at our house. Maybe we need to invite people over for, come have a charcuterie board, or if Matthew's making it that day, a matchutery board, or I don't know. Creative. So anyway, back to the this Thursday night, 6 p.m. in Barrett Hall. There's a sign up in the back. So just so we don't have an all salami charcuterie board, or an all, I don't know, whatever your favorite thing is, olives, whatever is on there. There's a sign up for actually what you're going to bring. So if you come to Wednesday night and you go, I did not sign up, that's okay. Come anyway. You are welcome. So you're going to bring whatever you sign up for, and the tray will actually be built as you come. So more directions that evening. And then just a reminder about the 9 a.m. equipping hour. We're starting the family project on April 3rd. And you can contact either the office or Dan Conley if you have questions on that, and to order a book. And then just a few more prime timers. There's a sign up in the lobby for a luncheon on 4-2. And then a Grace 101 class is coming up next Sunday at the 9 a.m. hour in the library. This is really for new people that want to learn about our church and what we believe and get to know people. So no sign up is necessary. Just show up next Sunday, 9 a.m. library. And then just a reminder about three different ways we have to give for offering here. We have the wooden box in the back. You can mail it in, or we have an app online, the Vanco app. And just thank you for continuing just to joyfully and so graciously give to the church. So have a blessed and wonderful Sunday.
If you're able to, please stand. We're going to read our passage for the morning. This is Acts chapter 19, verses 11 through 20. And God was doing extraordinary miracles by the hands of Paul, so that even handkerchiefs or aprons that had touched his skin were carried away to the sick, and their diseases left them, and the evil spirits came out of them. Then some of the itinerant Jewish exorcists undertook to invoke the name of the Lord Jesus over those who had evil spirits, saying, I adjure you by the Jesus who Paul proclaims. Seven sons of a Jewish high priest named Sceva were doing this. But the evil spirit answered them, Jesus I know, and Paul I recognize, but who are you? And the man in whom was the evil spirit leaped on them, mastered all of them, and overpowered them, so that they fled out of that house naked and wounded. And this became known to all the residents of Ephesus, both Jews and Greeks, and fear fell upon them all. And the name of the Lord Jesus was extolled. Also, many of those who were now believers came, confessing and divulging their practices. And a number of those who had practiced magic arts brought their books together and burned them in the sight of all. And they counted the value of them and found it came to 50,000 pieces of silver. So the word of the Lord continued to increase and prevail mightily. You may be seated.
I'm not sure how to begin this message today based upon that video that I made with regard to, I don't know if I should wear a baseball cap backwards or, you know, talk. I can't do the accent she was doing in that video. But anyway, I'm grateful for surprises and honoring me, really, in those senses. Welcome today. If you are new today, today's the first day you're visiting. My name is Mark. I'm the lead pastor here at Grace Fellowship and have the privilege to bring the message today. And so welcome to you. And I also want to bring attention. And as just on a somber note, many of you know Ron and Vicki Bertrand, who moved out of our area a few years ago. They moved to Sparks, Nevada. And so on. Ron, who had been battling cancer, went to be with the Lord. And if you didn't know that, I want to let you know that. If you want to reach out to Vicki and give her a phone call, a text, or a card, I'm sure that would be very appreciated. And anytime we announce the passing of someone in our fellowship or a former member of our body, you know, we experience sadness and grief, but that also should be mixed with hope. The Bible tells us, the Apostle Paul, you know, we grieve just like the rest of men. But unlike the rest of men, we do not grieve without hope. Because one day, when Jesus comes again and recreates the heavens and the earth, according to the book of Revelation and many prophecies that foretell of this event, the Bible tells us that sin and death will be done away with completely. It will no longer be something we experience. And that this mortal body, which is subject to death and sickness and pain and fear and suffering, will no longer be a part of our experience. Will we receive our new bodies according to the scriptures? Not unlike Jesus' resurrected body. Not only did he triumph over death, but he rose from the grave with this glorified body that he promises that you and I will also experience. I'm looking forward to that. I'm tired of this body sometimes, you know. It doesn't always act the way I want it to act. And with each year that progresses in my life, there are new things that it tells me that I'm not built to last forever. And so I'm grateful for the hope of eternal life. I'm grateful for the hope of the kingdom that is to come. And I pray with hope for the return of Christ, which I pray is soon. And so we grieve with Vicki, but we also rejoice in the hope of all of our future in that place. Our faith as Christians speak to that end. So before we jump into the word this morning, let's stop and pray and prepare our hearts for today. Father, thank you for each of the elements of this service that we have already experienced, lifting up the name of Jesus with the words that we sing, confessing our own sin, and acknowledging the blood of Jesus that covers that sin, that we can be forgiven, that we can be partakers of the divine nature through our faith in Jesus and the elements of communion reminding us of the blood and body of Jesus that was poured out, was sacrificed for us, that we can gather here, enjoy our common spirit, our common faith in Jesus, and learn of you. God, reveal to us afresh who you are through your word today. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So the passage today bears a very interesting situation, right? We have these guys that are going around casting out evil spirits, and this is not something new in that world that really believed very literally in the spiritual realm that we cannot see. And we know in Jesus' ministry, he cast out many demons. from people who were experiencing oppression and possession by these demons, and it would manifest in all kinds of ways, including epilepsy and other things, that once the demon was exorcised, the person was whole. They were healthy once again. And though in our modern thinking, sometimes we remove ourselves from the spiritual nature of things. We like to think of things we can see and touch, and we can see on an X-ray and or whatever, and that's all good and a part of our world that we live in. But the Bible helps us to understand that there is a very real spiritual realm that is in play. That not only does God exist, whom we can't see because he is spirit, but also so does Satan, so does demons, so do angels exist and are very active in the spiritual realm and in fact are doing battle and waging war and taking ground and losing ground in the spiritual realm. And we, through our faith in Jesus and through our prayers, actually affect this part of the reality that we cannot see. And Paul would say in Ephesians, the very place that he is in today's text, in the city of Ephesus, he would write to them and say, put on the full armor of God to protect ourselves from these fiery arrows of the enemy. There's a very real spiritual realm, whether we acknowledge it or not. It is real. It is reality. And this little vignette in Paul's experience in the city of Ephesus kind of brings this to attention, but also the response of those who were not taking it as seriously as they ought to have been. So here we are. If you have your Bible, turn to Acts chapter 19, and I'm going to grab my little clicker here, and we're going to roll through. In your bulletin, there's a space for notes if you would like to take some notes this morning. And the purpose of today's message, and I believe the focus of this passage, is to elevate the honor due the name of Jesus. And so because that's true, I'm going to start with two questions. The first is this, that we need to examine our hearts and reflect upon. Number one, am I giving honor due the name of Jesus? Am I doing that with my words, with my actions, my thoughts? Do I give honor to the name of Jesus? And secondly, when we reflect upon that question in our hearts, our minds, if not, what do I need to do? Is there something how I should respond? Is there something I need to respond to and act as a result? Once I reflect, is there some aspect of the honor that I ought to be giving Jesus that I'm not? And if so, what should I do? Two questions that hopefully we will answer well in today's passage. So in Acts chapter 19, beginning with verse 11, we see that Paul has been in the city of Ephesus. He'll have been here for a year and a half. And there's two things that happen that Luke draws attention to. Obviously, you're there that much of the time. There's a lot of things that are happening. But here are the two that Luke chooses to highlight, beginning with verse 11, and we'll tackle the second one next Sunday. First of all, extraordinary miracles were happening at the name of Jesus. So when you think about this, there's an important word here that we should draw attention to because Luke uses it, and that's the word extraordinary. I think about any miracle, if I were to witness someone who could not speak, and now they were able to speak when someone laid hands upon them, prayed in the name of Jesus to speak, and all of a sudden they could. If someone were blind and they began to see as a result of having faith that Jesus could heal them, and there's, we had somebody who, like the Apostle Paul, who laid hands upon them, and then, you know, All of a sudden, they were able to see. They were lame, and they began to walk. I mean, these are the quality of miracles that are happening in the book of Acts that we've seen to this point. Why aren't those miracles called extraordinary? They're great and mighty deeds, for sure. I mean, it's call it attention to the work of God through the apostles, Peter and John and Paul and so on. But here, he uses the word extraordinary, and it calls attention to the unusual character or unusual nature of these particular miracles that are happening in the city of Ephesus. Up to this point, you know, the other miracles that we see, it's like, oh yeah, God does that, you know, all the time, right? People who could not walk are now walking, blind can see, deaf are now hearing. But now, handkerchiefs and aprons are being carried to people and somehow touching them, and they are being healed, and evil spirits are coming out of them as a result. So this is unusual. Up until this point, we see that the apostles are laying hands on people. They're physically present, and this kind of thing is happening. And now these garments are being taken. So I would agree that somehow this is unusual. This is extraordinary. And Luke doesn't give any more reference to this other than it was noteworthy. Doesn't explain what it was fulfilling, or that there was some particular sense of the power of God that was being drawn out. It was just making an observation that at this point in time, God was using these crazy things. So a handkerchief. So think about, Paul was a tent maker. Paul was one who worked oftentimes during the day, and he would preach at night, and he would preach on the weekend. And so, by virtue of that, you're working in a hot environment, a dirty environment, as a tent maker, a leather worker, whatever you want to interpret his occupation. And the workers would often wear, just like today, if you work in a shop and dust and everything, oftentimes you'll wear an apron. So stuff doesn't, you know, gets on, not your clothing, but you can just take the apron on, put a different apron on, and you can retain the garments that you're actually wearing, so they're free of stain and so on. And the handkerchiefs is something they would wear on their head because, you know, of sweat and so on in that environment. It's kind of a sweat rag, if you will, on their head, so that the sweat wouldn't roll down in their eyes and be a problem while they're doing the work, or drip onto the work itself. That might, you know, cause a stain or something. So they're just very practical items. There's nothing out of the ordinary about these items. And so these, which touched Paul's skin, he actually wore, somehow God was using to heal people. By them having their faith in God, God was doing the work, but he's using these extraordinary or unusual ways of healing. So I can't comment any more on this. If you go and read commentaries about this, commentators are, they range from, we don't know why Luke includes this, all the way to that Luke is making this part up. Now, I don't fall into either camp. I think it can be known. And I certainly don't believe Luke is making this part up. And so I think there is explanation for this, if only to explain the greater context of what's about to happen. So these extraordinary things are happening, and people are seeing these extraordinary things happening, and they are themselves are acting upon them. So we'll move to the idea of the name of Jesus. So diseases are being are leaving people who are being healed by God, and spirits are coming out all at the hands of Paul through God in the name of Jesus, so that people who were kind of in the very aware of the spiritual realm of things, particularly these Jewish exorcists who weren't believers in Christ, they had made their living or their notoriety by exorcising demons or casting demons out or creating some sort of event that appealed to the supernatural. And everyone, it was very common in the culture that everybody believed. Obviously, if you're from a Greek mindset, the pantheon of gods. If you are a Jewish mindset, you believe in the one true God. But everybody believed in good spiritual things out there, beings, and bad spiritual beings. And you wanted the bad spiritual beings to be kept at bay. So you make, you know, if I'm a pagan in that culture, I'm going to go to various temples to offer sacrifices. But even if those don't appease some negative thing that's happening in my life and I can't figure it out, I'm going to call upon maybe one of these exorcists, someone who is known to have to wield authority in the spiritual realm. Now, there's many of them, and they're making money by this, by the way, at doing this. And so you can imagine that the motives for helping others, in quote, may not be pure. That I'm doing this to gain a name for myself. I'm doing this to get money and so on. And so that being a motive somewhere in there, maybe what I'm doing is not real. Maybe I'm saying and doing certain things, calling upon certain things, uttering certain incantations and spells and whatever, making a show and drawing people to me rather than anything else and giving me money for my services and whatnot. And so this is happening in this city, this very diverse culture. There's lots of temples as well as a significant Jewish presence. And in verse 13, it says, some of the itinerant Jewish exorcists undertook to invoke the name of the Lord Jesus. So clearly, Paul is teaching the name of the Lord Jesus. He is healing people in the name of the Lord Jesus. And these guys, these people are observing, wow, there's something powerful about the name of Jesus. We want to add that to our collection of incantations, our spells, or whatever we're going to do to continue our own business. They're seeing the extraordinary things that are happening, and they want in. So they would go around and go to someone who had an evil spirit, and they would say, I adjure you by the Jesus whom Paul proclaims. Now, the wording here is very appropriate that Luke uses because it's being said by someone who you don't get any impression by this wording they have any relationship with Jesus themselves. I've heard about the name. I see the power of the name through Paul. And so, you know, if there's lots of Jesuses around, this was a common name of the first century. And so that I'm going to invoke this authority on this evil spirit, on the Jesus whom Paul preaches, that we've seen these extraordinary miracles take place. So they invoke the sacred name of Jesus in order to accomplish their own goals. So this idea, the word of invoke the name, is to say the name in a ritual sense, an incantation or a magic spell, if you will. This is Harry Potter stuff that they're doing. And they're using the name of Jesus as a very powerful name to try to expel evil spirits from people. And Luke uses the word, I adjure you. I mean, it's not a word, at least in my active vocabulary, though, you know, obviously it's our passive vocabulary. We've heard of this, but what exactly is meant here? Luke says this by a means of declaring an oath, that is to wield the authority based upon the name of Jesus. Authority they have not been given by God, but they're claiming it nonetheless. Now let's back up for a second and talk about the sacred name of God and how the Jews would have looked at that. One of the commandments says that we should not take the Lord's name in vain. Now, Orthodox Jews who are sincerely believing in and hold up the name of the Lord in their faith and in their life and their practices of all of through the Old Testament, they came to understand that this commandment, which don't take the Lord's name in vain, which is really literally pointing to don't make a vow and then don't uphold your vow. Don't make a vow in the name of God and then not follow through with it. That's taking the Lord's name in vain, making a false vow. But they, out of honor for the name, would expand that you couldn't even pronounce the name of God, because we, to put a human pronunciation to the name of God, who can't really be, it's this sense of honor. We can't really even say the name because of the high honor we hold for the name of the Lord. And to this day, Orthodox Jews will not say the I Am, the Hebrew word that reflects God's self-designated name, I Am. What we would say, Yahweh. And I apologize if that is offensive to anyone in this room. But we sometimes hold it, we'll say that name all day long as the name of God. We don't hold that, but somehow I think, should we consider that a little bit? And certainly as we think about the name of Jesus. So this is their mindset. There is power in the name of the Lord, which they themselves won't say as a Jew. In fact, when I was studying Hebrew in seminary, when we were reading texts of the Old Testament, we had to read aloud to practice saying Hebrew and reading and speaking. Every time we would get to a Hebrew word that was the designated name of God, the I Am of God, we were taught not to say that word. Instead, we would substitute a word, Adonai, instead of saying what you might call Yahweh. And even Yahweh is a kind of a misunderstanding of the pronunciation, because in Hebrew, I didn't mean to talk about all this, so this is just a parenthetical thought here. In Hebrew, there are only consonants in the language. You may not know this. The letters of the alphabet of Hebrew, there are no vowels. Now, of course, we need vowels to say words, but to be concise, they would use only consonants. And as you read the text, you would also be reflecting in your mind the oral tradition. You're used to hearing these sentences you're reading in your ear, and you can read them and fill in the blanks with the vowels. Later, because ancient Hebrew no longer is spoken, scholars would come back and take those vowels or the consonants in the alphabet in our Old Testament text, and they would create little notations and markings around those consonants called vowel markers. And it's like a secret code, it really looks like. Little checks and underlines and accents, so that the modern reader can see the consonants. And using little vowel pointings and markers, you could pronounce the word. Well, every time in a modern reader, you can take a Hebrew text, every time you see the word that is the I Am of God, the wrong vowel markers are appearing with that word. It's done by design. So that you look at that and like, it should make you think twice about, wait a second, what is going on? That's not the right vowels to these consonants. It doesn't even make sense. And it's a trigger for you to stop and not say that word. That's why it's there. And so because of the modern vowel markings and the ancient consonants, we get the pronunciation Yahweh. So may or may not be actually how that word is said, if that makes sense. And so because of this protection, this guarding of the sacred, holy nature of the name of God that they wouldn't even say for fear of saying the Lord's name in vain, they would make up a different word. They would use the word Lord instead, Adonai, every time they come upon this word. So here are these Jews who are exorcists who had this greater cultural understanding of the sacredness and the holiness and the power of names that they wouldn't even pronounce. And they hear the name of Jesus and the power that's associated with them. They said, okay, we're going to use that. We don't have the same honor for that as our understanding of the one true God, the I Am. We're going to start using that name, and we're going to wield it like a magic spell for our own ends. Nevertheless, the name of Jesus, as it applies to someone like the Apostle Paul, carries a great amount of honor, a great amount of sacredness. And so there's a problem. They're using the name to their own ends, which leads us to a particular case study of seven sons of Sceva. So let's look at verse 14. Seven sons of the Jewish high priest named Sceva were doing this. So here's an example. There's a bunch of people apparently doing this kind of stuff. And here's an example of these particular sons of the high priest Sceva. And there's no record of a high priest named Sceva. It could be a self-titled thing to draw attention to that they are someone who's important. It's hard to imagine someone of the high priestly realm having seven kids who are doing this stuff. But, you know, we all either are a son or a daughter that's maybe doing things that our parents wouldn't, you know, like, or we have children ourselves. But that could be true. It just doesn't seem, it doesn't ring true of history. So these supposed seven sons of a Jewish high priest named Sceva were doing this. Verse 15. But the evil spirit answered them. So they're saying, we adjure you in the name of Jesus, the sacred name, to come out of this person. And here's that evil spirit's response when they did this. But the evil spirit answered them, Jesus, I know. We know this person you're talking about. We know the sacredness and the power of the actual Son of God. And Paul, I recognize, but Paul, because Paul had been used mightily by God to cast out demons, they would have feared, perhaps, Paul acting in the authority of Jesus. But who are you? You don't have the same authority. You don't have any relationship, any connection to Jesus, and yet you're using the name. This is strange, even to demons. Who are you? You have no authority over us to call upon that name, essentially. And so this is the result. In verse 16, and the man in whom was the evil spirit leaped on them, mastered all of them, and overpowered them. So in the Greek, which is the original language of the New Testament, these words put together really are meant to picture a tremendous violence, mastering, overpowering. The guy attacked them, and they are very fortunate not to have been killed. They had no power, no authority. Physically, they could do nothing against this person. He had great strength, and no one could bind him. This is it makes me think of when Jesus healed the man that dwelt on the far side of the sea, the Sea of Galilee, and dwelt among the tombs. And people tried to bind him, tried to subdue him. And he had such strength because of these evil spirits in him. He would always break the binds and no one could do anything about it. Whereas Jesus went there, and they said, who are you? And they said, we are legion, for we are many. There's a lot of spirits in this one guy. And Jesus casts those spirits out just with the word of his power, just proclaiming his own authority as a son of God. Yet in this case, the demon had all the power, but the seven sons of Sceva did not. They had no authority. And so they fled out of that house naked and wounded, their clothes ripped from them, bruised and beaten, likely humiliated. They ran from there. And this became known everywhere. Everybody saw this. Everybody heard about this. And because of the widespread nature of that, there was a particular response, especially those who believed in Jesus. And here's where I'm creeping back into the original question we asked. Do we honor the name of Jesus? What was their response? What we're finding out is that if they're asking that themselves the same question, they would have to answer, no, I wasn't honoring the name of Jesus like I thought. And what should I do about it? Well, their first response is fear and honor. Look at verse 17. And this became known to all the residents of Ephesus. It's a big city. Both Jews and Greeks. And fear fell upon them all. Their first response is, we should have a greater honor, a reverential fear for the power and authority of God represented in Jesus. And because we recognized that we weren't holding it quite with the honor that was due this name, they lifted up the name of Jesus. So this is would be a common response. So Old Testament, if someone were to say the name of God, the I Am, if someone unknowingly or somehow it slipped out as they're reading Scripture and they said the name and they were like, you said the name of God, what they would do literally, very practically, would stop what they were doing and they would begin to worship God and praise God and begin to lift up the name of God for fear that they weren't taking seriously who God was. This is a similar response. When they realize, I guess I wasn't taking quite so seriously the name, the person of Jesus Christ, the authority, the power of Jesus, who, though sinners at the hand of sinful men, crucified him, buried him, he was dead, he was raised from the dead on the third day. But the very power of God in him that he gave through the Spirit to the apostles who could also raise the dead, who could also heal just like Jesus did. I guess I wasn't honoring that honor, that name, that power, the person of Jesus quite to the degree that I needed to. They stop and they begin to lift up. They begin to extol the name of Jesus, to bring it up, to give him honor due. And if we keep reading, we see the second half of their response is confession and repentance. Verse 18. Also, many of those who were now believers came, confessing and divulging their practices. So these are Christians, people that have been baptized, placed their faith in Jesus, praising God, living out their faith, you know, to some degree. And now it's been brought to their attention that these seven sons of Sceva, whom they probably honored in their own life. Well, these people are powerful. They have power in the dark realms and so on to cast out demons. All of a sudden, they are overmastered and overpowered and running naked and bleeding. It's like, oh my goodness, this name has greater honor and power than I even imagined it to be. And so they begin to confessing, we ourselves had put our faith in Jesus and in these other spiritual practices that bring down the name of Jesus. These books that have spells and incantations, magic arts. It's like, yes, I believe that Jesus has the power over demons, but I also believe in these books, these incantations, this other ways of accessing protection against the harmful demons and spirits. It's Jesus and they realize that is a slap in the face of the very one who saved them. And they confessed, yeah, we thought the same way. We didn't think anything of what they were doing before, but now we know that God doesn't like that. And having come to that knowledge, we're going to take these books out and we're confess, yeah, we were doing the same thing. We were believing in similar ways. And now that has been brought to light, I confess it. We divulge that we were doing the same things, and they would bring these books out. Verse 19, number of those who had practiced magic arts brought their books together and burned them in the sight of all. Unless we think this was a small thing, I can burn a copy of some book I don't like, and that's probably not going to be that impressive. But in this culture, these books were valued at 50,000 pieces of silver. If that sounds like a lot of money, it is. One piece of silver is equal to one day's wage. So if you do the math, you can see that this is a tremendous amount of money that they had invested in these particular books that now they see was not only of no value to them, the possession of them actually brought down the name of Jesus. They weren't honoring him. And so they confessed. They brought it all together, put them in a big pile, and lit them on fire. Not only are we going to get rid of them, we're going to destroy them. We don't want anybody else to own them. It is this idea of I'm going to stop. I'm going to confess. I'm going to stop doing these things. I'm going to turn my face back to. That's the idea of repentance. You were facing one way, and you face another. And when you turn, you face to Jesus. I'm going to repent. I'm going to stop this practice. I'm going to burn these books. In the very last verse of our section, we see the result is the word of the Lord continued to increase and prevail mightily. God was pleased with that. It's like, yes, that's what I want you to do. You don't need that stuff. You honor the name of Jesus. So let's come back to our original questions. Am I, this seems like removed from me, but I'm not doing what these exorcists are doing. But am I somehow giving honor to the name of Jesus? Or if I am not, what do I need to do? Is my life, are my words, my actions, consistently honoring the name, and by that name, all authority and power associated with the name of Jesus? Or do I kind of treat Jesus like a magic spell? Like, yep, I'm saved. That's all I need. I can continue to just do what I want to do with my life. I'm going to make my own choices. We ignore the fact that God reached down out of heaven, the creator of all things, the sustainer of all things, Jesus himself, who spoke the universe into existence, who he himself humbled himself to become a man, to live a life just like you and me so that we could understand God more fully. He himself represented us by going to the cross and dying in our place, who was crucified, who died, who was buried, who by the very power of God rose from the dead. And we say, that's great, Jesus, thanks for that, but I'm just going to live my life by my choices, my preferences, what I want to do. And in passages like this, what happens when those people were treating the name of Jesus something less than the honor due him, we see that not only is God not pleased, but things are allowed to take place for them to understand more clearly judgment from God, that it was allowed to take place so they might repent. They might confess and repent. Am I living in such a way to bring honor to the name of Jesus? And what has been revealed somehow in this crazy passage, as I reflect on my own heart and my own life, are there things that I give way to, that I allow in my life that bring dishonor for what God has done for me in Jesus? Am I honoring? And if not, what do I do? And what we do, if not, I'm telling you, I'll just be transparent, won't go into great detail, but I recognize daily, nearly, how I do not fully honor the name of Jesus with my life and my words and my thoughts, how I treat people, how I treat my wife, how I live my life. There are other competing desires, there are other competing priorities in my life that, when I am honest, do not honor Jesus to the degree the name, which in some circles you can barely pronounce the name without feeling a sense of awe. Honestly, I could point to many examples that I don't hold that kind of esteem and honor and value to the name of Jesus with my life and my words and my thoughts, how I treat people, so on. So what should I do? It is simple. We confess and we repent.
And we do it again, and we do it again, and we do it again. The purpose is to lift up the name of Jesus and subordinate my own, any actions or thoughts or deeds, words that would bring that name down. Lift up Jesus, confess, and repent. Other writers of Scripture say it this way. 1 John chapter 1, verses 7 through 9 says, if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus cleanses us from all sin. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves. The truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins, to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. God is wanting to move toward us when we confess. God is wanting to move toward us when we repent. He wants to restore that relationship. He wants honor due his name. But he wants to reach down and lift up when we confess and repent. That is the proper response. And we do it again, and we do it again. James 4, 7 through 10 says, submit yourselves therefore to God. Resist the devil. He will flee from you. Draw near to God. He will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners. Purify your hearts, you double-minded. Be wretched and mourn and weep. This is the act of confession and recognizing truly some of the things that are in our heart that are contrary, dishonoring to the name of Jesus. Let your laughter be turned to mourning, your joy to gloom. Humble yourselves before the Lord, and he will exalt you. He wants to lift us up when we honor him the way he ought to be honored. We all fall short. Do we in turn confess and repent and then lift up the name of Jesus? That's what he wants us to do. And so as we conclude our time here, I want to sing a song reflective of this idea. I want to give us a chance in these moments to think and reflect. I'm going to invite Martha to come up. She's going to sing it with me. And you can sit, you can stand, you can kneel, you can come forward. Reflect. And then move according to how God directs you. If you want to come forward and just... no judgment here. We're all, if I weren't playing the piano, I'd be right down there.
Forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted. You were condemned. And I'm alive and well. Your spirit is within me because you died and rose again. Amazing love, how can it be that you, my King, would die for me? Amazing love, I know it's true. It's my joy to honor you in all I do. I'm forgiven. I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted. You were condemned. And I'm alive and well. Your spirit is within me because you died and rose again. My King would die for me. Amazing love, I know it's true. It's my joy to honor. In all I do, I honor you.
Father God, we do confess our hearts before you. We ask you to purge from within us anything that would be dishonoring to the glorious, wonderful, beautiful name of Jesus. We repent. We turn back to you. And we lift up your name with our lives, our thoughts, our words. Help us by the power of your Spirit to do this afresh today. In the name of Jesus, we pray. And all God's people said, amen, amen. Go in peace.